At all times in history, God has sent messengers to warn their own societies. They have taught their societies of the wisdom of God, preached the true religion, and warned people of the day of judgment. One of these holy individuals is Prophet Sulayman, peace be upon him. God bestowed a great kingdom, incomparable wealth, a mighty army supported by jinns and birds, and superior knowledge upon him. The Qur'an contains a great many stories regarding Prophet Sulayman, and there are most important advice and lessons in each one of these. In addition, there is another striking aspect to these stories. They contain signs of the end times. Prophet Dawud, peace be upon him, was one of the prophets sent by God to the children of Israel. God revealed the Book of Psalms to Prophet Dawud, who possessed superior knowledge and faith. And later, he gave him glad tidings of another gift. We gave to Dawud Sulayman. What an excellent servant! He truly turned to his Lord. Prophet Sulayman came to the children of Israel as a prophet. And, just like the other prophets, he called on the children of Israel to believe in God and to abide by the proper moral values revealed by him. He, Sulayman, said, "My Lord, forgive me and give me a kingdom the like of which will never be granted to anyone after me. Truly, you are the ever-giving." God accepted his prayer and bestowed upon him great blessings, superior wisdom, and more possessions than anyone else could attain, and a glorious kingdom. His kingdom, based on the city of Jerusalem, became the most powerful state of the time. Prophet Sulayman had a mighty army, the likes of which had never been seen. It was composed of jinns, birds, and men, and was supported by a strong intelligence network. God has revealed the following about this army. Sulayman's troops, made up of jinns and men and birds, were assembled for him, paraded in tight ranks. His army was very disciplined, for the three groups that formed it worked together very harmoniously and without the slightest problem. Prophet Sulayman possessed great wealth and magnificent power. But his true aim was to use the blessings given by God in his path. Because he possessed superior moral values, and was a role model for all mankind. What an excellent servant! He truly turned to his Lord. One of the most important attributes of Prophet Sulayman revealed in the Quran is without a doubt his deep faith and superior moral values. God tested him with events, both good and bad. However, when he encountered any difficulty, anxiety, or blessing, he immediately turned towards God. He made every decision with his name in mind, and always took refuge in his generous mercy. God has revealed the moral values of Prophet Sulayman in these terms in the Quran. Sulayman said, "This is part of my Lord's favor, to test me to see if I will give thanks or show ingratitude. Whoever gives thanks only does so to his own gain. Whoever is ungrateful, my Lord is rich beyond need, generous. It is revealed in the Quran that Prophet Sulayman had a great love of animals. For instance, he devoted a certain amount of time to horses. The true reason for this love was the admiration he felt for God's flawless creative artistry. In other words, in watching his horses, he was remembering God due to the perfection of his creation. Prophet Sulayman loved his possessions and the splendor of his wealth again because they made him remember God. God has revealed this superior attribute in the Quran. Sulayman said, "Truly do I love the love of good because of the remembrance of my Lord." In short, while possessing power that had been granted to no one else, Prophet Sulayman always felt a deep and sincere respect for God. And he used all his means to serve his religion. God endowed Prophet Sulayman with superior knowledge and blessings, and these are clearly revealed in the Quran. Prophet Sulayman was known for his strong sense of justice. He judged with truth, like his father, Prophet Dawud, and solved all disputes most justly. His attitude following the loss of the hoopoe bird was one of the finest examples of this. It is revealed in the Quran that there was a bird called the hoopoe in Prophet Sulayman's army, and that one day, when inspecting his army, the Prophet was unable to see the hoopoe. Still, he inflicted no sudden penalty. First, he listened to it carefully and asked it to produce clear proof. The Quran states, he, Sulayman, inspected the birds and said, "How is it that I do not see the hoopoe? Or is it absent without leave? I will certainly punish it most severely or slaughter it if it does not bring me clear authority." O people, we have been taught the speech of birds and have been given everything. This is indeed a clear favor. By God's permission, Prophet Sulayman learned to speak the language of birds. He formed an army squadron composed of birds and commanded them as he wished. This information is both noteworthy and thought-provoking because modern science has indeed revealed that birds have their own unique way of speaking to one another. This communication takes place on a wavelength inaccessible to the human ear. Prophet Sulayman might have been given a knowledge to understand these conversations, which might have been made possible by technological means. God knows the truth. It appears from the verses that Prophet Sulayman achieved important results by using birds to both carry messages and gather information. This knowledge facilitated communication with other countries and reaching distant areas. this verse may be drawing our attention to a superior technology, similar to that which will be used in the end times. In fact, these birds may not even refer to birds as we know them, but perhaps to unmanned aircrafts. Prophet Sulayman also established control over the jinns and the demons. God reveals this in Surah Sabah. And some of the jinns worked in front of him by his Lord's permission. When considered from this point of view, it may have been an army made up of jinns that looked like birds. Or these birds may have been controlled by jinns, who Prophet Sulayman could use to make the birds do what he wanted them to do. God knows the truth. Then, when they reached the Valley of the Ants, an ant said, "Ants! Enter your dwellings, so that Sulayman and his troops do not crush you unwittingly." He, Sulayman, smiled, laughing at his words, and said, "My Lord, keep me thankful for the blessing you have bestowed on me and my parents. Keep me acting rightly, pleasing you, and admit me by your mercy among your servants who are righteous." Interesting information emerges when these verses are considered. The female ant knew that Prophet Sulayman and his army were entering the valley. This is an extremely conscious recognition. These ants could speak to one another and were aware of what was happening around them. This suggests that these creatures may have been jinns. God knows the truth. Prophet Sulayman's ability to hear the ants talking among themselves may indicate a development that will occur in computer technology in the end times, for the Valley of the Ants suggests a special place and special ants. The modern term, Silicon Valley, refers to the center of the world of technology. Thus, it is very significant that the verse mentions the Valley of the Ants. And today, using ants and other insects as models, robots are being developed to serve humanity in such varied areas as the defense industry and various technological fields. These verses may be signaling such developments. "And to Sulayman we gave the fiercely blowing wind, speeding at his command toward the land that we had blessed. And we had full knowledge of everything." God allowed Prophet Sulayman to control the wind and use it as a tool. This may be a reference to the use of wind energy in Prophet Sulayman's time. The term, fiercely blowing wind, in the verse is also of the greatest interest. This phrase may be drawing our attention to a technology that will be developed in the end times, aircraft technology. "And we made a fount of molten copper flow out for him." There was another great blessing given to Prophet Sulayman. Molten copper. Copper is one of the best conductors of electricity and heat, and plays a significant role in producing electricity. At this point, the verse may be indicating a most important fact. The advanced technology in the time of Prophet Sulayman developed by using electricity. The verse contains a most unambiguous term, flow out. This may point to the great amounts of electricity produced and its widespread use in Prophet Sulayman's time. God knows the truth. Moreover, in the verse the term Aina al-Kitri is employed. Many Quranic commentators have interpreted these words as referring to petroleum. Today, petroleum is the most basic raw material of technology. In his time, Prophet Sulayman may have used it in technological operations. God knows the truth. God has revealed that he placed certain demons and jinns under Prophet Sulayman's command, and he used them on artistic works, in construction activities, and many other areas. God reveals this thus in the Quran. And some of the demons dived for him, Sulayman, and did other things apart from that. And we were watching over them. In the same way that this verse contains important information about that time, it may also hold some indications regarding the end times. The verses refer to entities diving in the sea. This verse may inform us of the importance of processing both underground and marine riches. But in order to do so, highly advanced technology is needed. At this point, some entities worked for Prophet Sulayman, and they may have given him technical support and provided human workforce. In the end times, through which we are living now, technology is advancing at great speed. Thanks to God's mercy of technology, undersea research is also making rapid progress, and the riches there are being discovered. Therefore, it is possible that the meaning of the verse points in this direction. God knows the truth. Various events that took place between Prophet Sulayman and the Queen of Saba are related in the Quran. The Sabaeans persisted in a perversion inherited from their ancestors. They worshipped the sun. The bird known as Hoopoe in Prophet Sulayman's army informed him that the Sabaeans were going along with Satan and ascribing partners to God and failing to keep the true path. Hoopoe said, "I found both her and her people prostrating to the sun instead of God. Satan has made their actions seem good to them and debarred them from the way, so they are not guided." After hearing the Hoopoe's information, Prophet Sulayman did not make a sudden decision. He ordered an investigation to ascertain its truth. This is a proof that he was a provident and just ruler. When the facts about the Sabaeans were certain, Prophet Sulayman sent a letter to the Queen of Saba. "Take this letter of mine and deliver it to them. Then withdraw from them a little and see how they respond." God reveals the content of this letter in the Quran. "Do not rise up against me, but come to me in submission. The letter's incisive, decisive, and clear style show that it was from a powerful ruler and have affected the queen and her council. Prophet Sulayman used his letter to explain God's religion and to warn them. He did not want to subjugate them to himself. Rather, he wanted to lead them toward God so that they might become Muslims. This shows that he was more interested in their belief system than in conquering Sabah. The Queen of Sabah immediately sought her advisor's advice. O Council, give me your opinion about this matter. It is not my habit to make a final decision until I have heard what you have to say. Their reply is revealed thus in the Quran. They said, "We possess strength and great military force. But the matter is in your hands, so consider what you command." Realizing that she could not defeat Prophet Sulayman militarily, the Queen of Saba decided to submit to his call. She said, "When kings enter a city, they lay waste to it and make its mightiest inhabitants the most abased. That is what they too will do." Then the Queen of Saba visited Prophet Sulayman, and she witnessed his great majesty. Greatly influenced by this, the Queen immediately believed and became a Muslim. She was told, "Enter the courtyard." But when she saw it, she supposed it to be a pool and bared her legs. He, Sulayman, said, "It is a courtyard paved with glass." She said, "My lord, I have wronged myself, but I have submitted with Sulayman to the Lord of all the worlds." There are a number of striking elements in this account. For instance, the floor is described as paved with glass. These words may indicate a particular technology of that time. The floor may have been a giant television screen placed in the palace's entrance. So, when she saw the screen, she thought that she was looking at water. These verses may be alluding to a different kind of technology which will be used in the end times. Simulation, for example. Today, simulation goggles let people think that they are in a different place than where they are. Prophet Sulayman's deep understanding of art, which we see in these verses, is a very good example for Muslims. He used this understanding to express his great love for God and his wonder at the marvels of his creation. Believing artists have produced beautiful works of art throughout history. With God's permission, the power of Muslim art will greatly increase in the end times. In these verses, God may be indicating that water will be used in the end times to produce decorative materials with advanced technology. These products, using water's aesthetic and clean appearance, may be used in beautiful things to recreate the splendor of Prophet Sulayman's time. Other verses concerning Prophet Sulayman and the Queen of Saba may also contain signs regarding the end times. He who possessed knowledge of the book said, I will bring it to you before the twinkling of your eye ceases. And when he, Sulayman, saw it standing firmly in his presence, he said, This is part of my Lord's favor, to test me to see if I will give thanks or show ingratitude. In these verses, the person referred to as he who possessed knowledge of the book says that he can bring the throne of the queen to Prophet Sulayman before the twinkling of an eye ceases. In other words, very quickly. This brings to mind a most astonishing phenomenon that may be experienced in the end times. Advanced image transfer technology. Thanks to the internet, people can send many kinds of information over long distances in a very short time. Just like the throne's transportation in the twinkling of an eye. The Quran informs us of another Muslim leader who ruled a great kingdom, Zulkarnain. His life was quite similar to Prophet Sulayman's. Like Prophet Sulayman, Zulkarnain was a ruler with great economic, military, and political power. Justice was at the forefront of his conception of dominion. He found solutions to problems using reason and faith. Furthermore, as revealed in the Quran, like Prophet Sulayman, he commanded jinns and used molten copper. The dominion exercised by Prophet Sulayman and Zulkarnain is very good news for all Muslims, because these accounts may contain important indications about the end times.
Ahir zamana yönelik son derece önemli işaretler bulunması muhtemeldir.
The golden age will be a time of wealth, splendor, beauty, happiness, and peace. Life on earth will be like paradise, because the Quran's morality will prevail throughout the world. Doubtless, this is a grace and good tidings from God. He announces in the Quran that God has promised those of you who believe and do right actions that He will make them successors in the land, as He made those before them successors, will firmly establish for them their religion, with which He is pleased, and give them, in place of their fear, security. The hadiths characterize the end times as a treacherous period in which the number of wars and conflicts will increase, and the world will be in general chaos because of the moral degeneration arising from people's rebellion against religious morality. In this period, natural disasters will be everywhere. Poverty will reach a previously unknown level. Crime rates will soar, and murder and massacre will follow each other. But this is only the first stage of the end times. In the second stage, God will use the Mahdi to rescue people from this chaos. And the golden age indicated in the verse will begin. The golden age will be a time when wars and conflicts will end. All irreligious ideologies that caused so much misery will be buried in the dark recesses of history, and the world will enjoy a period of justice and abundant blessings. Islamic morality will spread throughout the world, and people will stream toward religion. Some of the hadiths describe this dominance of Islamic morality, such as when our Prophet, may God bless him and grant him peace, speaks of the similarities between this period and the reigns of Prophet Sulayman and Zulkarnain. Some of these are as follows. The Mahdi will rule earth, just like Zulkarnain and Prophet Sulayman. There have been four kings on earth. Two were believers and two were unbelievers. The believers were Zulkarnain and Prophet Sulayman, and the unbelievers were Nimrod and Nebuchadnezzar. There will be a fifth king, from the people of my house. The term Mahdiism connotes the establishment of these two leaders' superior morality on a new, different, and broader foundation in the end time. The sovereignty of Islamic moral values is the most important common feature of all three ages. And there are others. By God's permission, Prophet Sulayman ruled over jinns and demons, spoke to birds, heard and understood ants talking among themselves. Of Zulkarnain, the Quran says, "We had encompassed that he had knowledge comprising essence near him, or all that he had in knowledge." Like these two blessed believers, the Mahdi also will have special knowledge. One hadith reveals the following. He is called the Mahdi because he is given guidance for a situation unknown to anyone. Our Prophet, may God bless him and grant him peace, also says that the Mahdi, like Prophet Sulayman, will know the language of animals and have power over human beings and jinns. The Mahdi speaks the language of birds and other animals. Therefore, his justice will manifest itself over all people and jinns. Prophet Sulayman used the jinns and demons under his command to construct high arches, statues, huge dishes and vats. Zulkarnain also used a very effective construction technique to build the barricade. The hadiths also allude to the great importance of construction in the Golden Age. One of these hadiths is as follows. The Mahdi works in the construction of Constantinople and other places. Prophet Sulayman used all his wealth and majesty for the benefit of Muslims. The Mahdi, too, will use the world's wealth to make God's religion supreme and establish peace and high moral standards throughout his realm. In his time, a tolerant dominion will prevail. There will be a Mahdi among the people. God will send him to make people rich. People will have comfort and good fortune, animals will have plenty to eat, and the soil will bring forth plants. Prophet Sulayman is a holy person whom every Muslim must take as a role model, just like the other prophet. All mankind must take his moral values and the attitudes he adopted towards events as role models, and must be devout, just, modest, rational, patient, and determined like him. because this path will lead believers to great successes and victories, not just in this world, but in the hereafter too. Furthermore, the signs in the stories about Prophet Sulayman are taking place in our day, one after the other. This is clear proof that a blessed age is approaching. God reveals the importance of the accounts regarding the prophets in the Quran. There is instruction in their stories for people of intelligence. This is not a narration which has been invented, but confirmation of all that came before, a clarification of everything, and a guidance and a mercy for people who believe.